The ties between rugby and the military have always been strong, but in this most testing of times, they were strengthened. From international players to those from local villages across the country, teammates signed up together and often died together. And underpinned by a shared set of values, such as loyalty, respect, and integrity.
If I should die, think only this of me, that there's some corner of a foreign field that is forever England.
As I stand here amongst the graves of those who died over 100 years ago in this incredibly peaceful and serene Tynecott Cemetery, I'm reminded in this day and age that sportsmen and women are put on a pedestal. And what brings the war home for me as a former England rugby international is that of the 6 million or so Allied fatalities, 27 of those were England rugby internationals. The entire England team who won the 1914 Grand Slam joined up to fight. Seven of them died. The impact of this becomes more shocking with familiarity. Imagine the same with the 2016 Grand Slam team.
Jack, so in 1914, England won the Grand Slam. Can you reflect on the respect maybe that you have for those players and what they did?
Yeah, I think, you know, massive respect. I think the whole team have massive respect for those guys that died. You know, we say it now, if it wasn't for them, you know, we probably wouldn't be doing what we're doing now. We probably wouldn't be playing in the team that we're playing and winning the Grand Slam this year. You know, I think for the team, that every single time they do put on an England shirt, it is that memory of people that have been before us and people that have worn that shirt before us. The things that they did do for us to put us in that situation and the reason why we're playing now.
For the England rugby players and sports stars of their era, who were role models but also idolised by millions, you can imagine the sense of duty but pressure they must have felt to be shining examples of courage and fortitude to their fellow countrymen.
If the cricketer had a straight eye, let him look along the barrel of a rifle. If a footballer had strength of limb, let him serve and march in the field of battle.
Ronald William Poulton-Palmer was born and educated in Oxford, where he studied engineering and excelled at sports. There was athletics and cricket, but more than anything else, there was rugby. Scoring a record 5 tries in his first varsity game, he went on to play 17 times for England. As well as being recognised as one of the all-time great attacking three-quarters, he was also a leader, captaining his country to the 1914 Grand Slam.
Martin Johnson, CBE, is a giant of a man with an unbreakable will to win. He inspired his team as England captain on 39 occasions, including a 15-match unbeaten run which led to World Cup victory in 2003. He is the only player in history to have led the Lions on 2 tours and was inducted into the IRB Hall of Fame in 2011 and voted England's greatest ever player.
What do you think are the qualities of a leader on a rugby field that stand him apart?
Well, I think number one, he was obviously a good player, so he could lead by example and what he did. He was obviously a superstar player, and that helps. But you need more than that. You need that integrity and for guys to follow you. He was one of those inspirational people that come along time to time that A, have the ability, and B, have the sort of personality and the charisma to do it as well. It's just such a great shame, not just for rugby, that he died along with so many others. It would have been a tragic loss for them, I'm sure, to lose him. And lose him in, you know, killed by a sniper. Yeah. You read stuff about snipers and how attritional it is and how it wears down morale of of soldiers when they lose someone, you know, not in action. They were, I think they were doing trench work, weren't they, or
yeah,
something?
Exactly that, yeah.
And you're just doing some manual work and bang, you've lost one of your guys, one of your top men. Would have been horrific, I'm sure. My great-grandfather died on the Somme in August 1916, yeah, Richard Johns. You hear that story as a youngster, you don't really understand until you're old what that whole thing would have meant for his family, growing up without a father, how difficult that would have been. And he was quite old, you know, he wasn't a young man, he wasn't 21, I think he was 28. So had a family, had a number of children. And again, I think he was just killed by shell fire.
Right.
In August 1916. Another, on my other side of my family, my mother's side, my great-grandfather's brother died on the first day of the Somme, July the 1st.
Yeah.
So that would have
probably 1916.
Been, yeah, advancing.
Was he, do you know what regiment he was?
Yeah, Durham Light Infantry he was with, yeah.
Okay.
So he has no known grave. He's on the Teatvale Memorial on the Somme.
Did you go and find his name?
Yeah.
His nameplate?
Yeah. He's on there. Clemenson. So, yeah, and where my great-grandfather has a known grave at a small cemetery in Conroy. They're very still, aren't they? Very quiet, just very, very, very well kept, very peaceful.
Do you find it quite a moving experience, kind of?
When you go there, although the landscape's changed and the trees have grown back and they've built houses, it's still sort of echoes, you know? It's not that long ago.
Ronnie Poulton-Palmer. From one international to another, I will never forget your sacrifice. Due to a combination of tactics, terrain, and the advancement in weaponry, the First World War was fought largely in trenches. Months and years were spent in the mud facing endless artillery and sniper fire, with the constant threat of mustard gas and the fateful order to go over the top. By the end of the war, each side had dug 12,000 miles of trenches, but the front line had hardly moved.
John Abbott King, affectionately known as Jack, was born in Yorkshire, where he worked as a farmer. A staunch member of the Henley team, he played for England as a forward 12 times, earning the reputation for his hard work and commitment to the cause.
Though he was only 5'5", his chest was 46 inches, earning him the nickname the Pocket Hercules.
Neil Back MBE was capped 66 times for England and 5 times for the British Lions. He redefined the role of the open side flanker after being overlooked until he was 25 because he was deemed too small. A technically gifted player, he pushed his body to new limits to prove to the selectors size didn't matter.
Jack King is a name you might know a little bit about, but actually the similarities between the two of you, albeit 100 years in between, are quite significant for me, you know, both having played for your country, being Grand Slam winners. But more important than that, Jack King was 5'5", which is a touch taller than you, and and he had his own dealings with, you know, adversity. So when he went to join in 1914, when war broke, he was on the farm with one of his Yorkshire mates, and he got his papers through, and Jack went down the recruitment office, and was denied entry to the Hussars because of his size. Can you reflect back on what it was like to be turned down? The disappointment that maybe he would have felt as well at the same time.
In my situation, it was announced and you were either in it or you weren't. There was no explanation why, whereas Jack went to sign up. And he was told quite clearly he wasn't big enough because of the rules that they had. So it must have been terribly disappointed because he wasn't able to join his teammates. So he found a different way, very much the same that I did. I had to go and find a different route to the top, and you know, he went and served for the country, which is incredibly brave, as I've said, and very admirable. He could have quite easily stayed at home in the safety and took advantage of that.
Yeah, so he went from the, I think it was a chance meeting with one of his colleagues that played for England, Lancelot Slocock, And he ended up then going and joining the Liverpool Scottish Regiment. And actually, they both ended up dying on the same day, attacking Waterlot Farming in Guillemot.
So the spot of land where Slocock and King were killed is actually directly in front of us, just somewhere in that field over there.
So Jack wrote a letter home just before going over the top for the last time. I'm absolutely A1 in every way, but one can never tell. And so as long as I don't disgrace the old rugby game, I don't think I mind.
I'm sure he thought about his family and friends, but if that was truly his dying thing, it just shows what a tremendous game rugby union is. It's not an individual sport, you're a part of a team, and I suppose being part of a regiment exactly the same, you want to do the best, and it wasn't just for you, it certainly wasn't for you. You know, I feel more for the loved ones he left at home, his three sisters that were managing the farm. They must have been distraught every day thinking about their brother being out there. And then to get the news that he wasn't coming home would have been devastating.
Yeah.
I think it's a really courageous letter because he's not sort of moaning or moping. He's been really positive. You know, as long as he doesn't let his fellow sort of regiment countrymen down, and he represents rugby in the positive way, then everything will be all right. If I bumped into Jack today and he was still with us, I'd just be full of admiration for what he did and the sacrifice he and his teammates gave for the country. I find it incredible. You know, thinking back to those times, war is always brutal. But back in 1914, that First World War, you knew there was a huge possibility in percentage you wouldn't come home. So I'm just full of admiration and I'll just shake his hand and probably give him a big hug.
World War I was also the first time aircraft were used significantly in battle. Not just for reconnaissance, but also for aerial combat and bombing.
Arthur Cyril Lowe, nicknamed Titch because of his slight frame, attended Dulwich School and excelled in many sports, but none more so than rugby, where he played on the wing for Cambridge and England. He won back-to-back Grand Slams in 1913 and 14 and scored 18 tries in 25 international matches. This tally remained a record until 1990, when another flying winger took over.
The England player who broke that record was Rory Underwood, MBE, England's all-time leading try scorer. His speed, power and calm under pressure made Rory Underwood the epitome of a flying winger. He is widely regarded as one of the all-time greats.
Guscott again. Guscott, the long one out to Underwood. Underwood going for the corner. Is it going to be a try? The try has been awarded and Rory Underwood has set a new English record. His 19th try for England, beating the record of the great Cyril Lowe, which has lasted since 1923.
What do you think it was like for someone like Cyril Lowe, who was essentially joining a completely new concept, which was the RFC?
Flying was still in its infancy, so I don't know what the stats are, but it wouldn't surprise me if the stats are people dying, because we were still trying to learn about it. And of course, it wasn't until at the end of the war when it became the RAF, and then the sort of progression of advancement of understanding about flying and tactics, you know, which was ideal, because obviously another 15, 20 years later, we were in another big battle. The thing to bear in mind, in the First World War, they didn't have parachutes. So, you know, getting out of an aircraft was a bit of an issue.
Well, you don't really, I suppose, do you? That's it. Yeah, you want to stay in it as long as possible.
It's difficult for us to understand the whole essence of society and culture in those days. as soon as they declared war,
we're in.
You know, yeah. It was the done thing.
What was it that really excited you about flying as a kid? Was it just...
Would you like to be Superman?
Wouldn't we all?
Yeah. I'd love to be able to jump off this balcony, just do the Superman, that freedom of flying and being able to go where you want to without, you know...
I'm scared of heights, so...
Well, yeah. Well, to be honest, I'm scared of heights as well.
Are you?
Yeah.
Genuinely?
Genuinely scared of heights. But strap me to an aircraft, turn me upside down at 30,000 feet and I got no problem.
Cyril Lowe's playing career spanned from 1913 to 1923, interrupted by the war. But he still managed to score 18 tries in just 25 games.
That's one hell of a hit rate.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Mine's just over 1 in 2, but his was like, you know, 1 in 1.5 or something, whatever it is. Yeah. It's a great hit rate. And of course, they played less games in those days, so he, even though he did over 10 years to put the war out the games in, he might have played 30, 40 games.
But that wasn't to be. Cyril Lowe became a fighter ace. With 9 confirmed victories in battle, he survived the war. But for many, returning to civilian life presented a very different struggle.
Speaking to some of the guys I know that went to war, having a bullet whiz past your aircraft is no different. Mm. You know, 2 things that come out of that is that nerves of being shot at and, you know, whizzing over your head and enemy aircraft and all that sort of stuff. Mm. And then suddenly you come back to life after the war to then go back to normality can sometimes be very difficult. When I became aware that he was an ex-pilot and obviously rugby player and I broke his record, there was an element of appreciation of what he did. Mm. I would like to think he would have been pleased that another pilot broke his record.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, you know, 18 years in the Air Force, I'm light blue, probably the shirt. Yeah, very proud of my time in the Air Force, very proud of my association in the Air Force, very proud to call myself a member of the Royal Air Force. And to think that I've carried on the banner, I'm very proud of that. So taking the banner on from him. And from that point of view, you know, long may that continue.
And it wasn't just the rugby players of England who made the ultimate sacrifice. Across the Allied forces, a similar sense of duty led to a repeated pattern. As with England, amongst them were the international players. France lost 22, Scotland 31, Wales 13, Ireland 8, Australia 10, South Africa 5, and New Zealand also lost 13. One of them was Dave Gallagher, the legendary captain of the 1905 All Blacks team. In 1916, at the age of 42, he joined up after his younger brother Douglas died in battle. A second brother, Henry, was also to fall, and Dave lost his own life, along with 3 other All Blacks at the Battle of Passchendaele in 1917. Shortly before his death, he fought in the Battle of Messines, where another rugby international, England's John Raphael, died. The two men had played against one another in 1905. Fine examples all of the spirit of rugby. By 1919, the war was finally over. A series of international inter-forces rugby matches were played across Britain and France as a celebration of peace. The tournament can be seen as an inspiration for the Rugby World Cup. It was no coincidence that by this time, the Allied forces had adopted rugby as its sport of choice, as it remains to this very day.